Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the fourth session of the TALC 2020 webinar series. Today, our speaker for the webinar is Dr. Sybil Thomas. She is a faculty at the Department of Education at University of Mumbai. Previously, she has worked in the Department of Adult and Continuing Education and Extension, and also as the principal of St. Xavier's Institute of Education in Mumbai. She was also a member of the core committees for MEd and MPhil syllabus revision for Mumbai University. We are pleased to welcome you, Dr. Thomas. I now invite you to begin the session.
Thank you, Ananya, and good morning to all of you. Before we begin this session, I thought we would begin it with a small poll that we would conduct. The question is, curriculum is the subject-wise list of topics to be taught in a particular class, a description of the role of a teacher and student, the total experience to provide it to children in as well as out of school, and everything that goes on in the classroom. Great. So all of you can see the results, right? So the maximum leaning, or 78%, feel that it is the total experience provided to the children in as well as out of school, okay, followed by everything that goes on in the school. And we also have some responses distributed along the option of subject-wise list of topics and a description of the role of teacher and student. Great. So with this kind of an understanding, so it's curriculum involves, most of us believe it is the total experience provided to the children. We'll move on to understand, therefore, as to today, what are we going to understand and see in this whole unit on curriculum studies? Okay, so broadly, our objectives for the day would be to see and to understand the different factors that influence a curriculum design. We would also try and acquire some knowledge of analyzing a curriculum. How do you analyze it? We will build relationships between the three levels of analysis of the curriculum. As you have gone through the readings that are given, there are three levels at which we levels of analysis of a curriculum. So we will see relationships between those levels. We will try and develop an awareness of our own beliefs of learning in relationship to curriculum. And we would appreciate the importance of understanding curriculum from the focus of learning theories. We would also begin the process of reflection on ways in which we can strengthen our participation in communities of practice for growth and development. With these objectives that we have in mind, we would quickly now move on to the first part as we would of this session. And at this point, I would like to again pose some questions, and I'm sure that whether students or teachers, we have asked these questions at some point or the other in our lives. Okay, the questions are, what should be taught? What aims in education are worth pursuing? How should or how would the old curriculum be different from the new? Now, as teachers, as students, these are questions that we have posed, we have said. And the process of inquiring into the answers of these questions will lead us in the domain of curriculum studies. Okay, so when we begin this process of even inquiry and finding out answers to such questions, we are entering into the domain of curriculum studies, and more specifically, we are entering into the understanding of the curriculum. Now, if that is the domain of curriculum studies and curriculum, which will provide an insight into such questions, we will broadly try and understand what then is a curriculum. If we were to talk about the curriculum, it is the knowledge that builds or provides a building block or a base for building up capabilities and values that every individual needs to have in a society. So in short, we are saying it is the socio-political and cultural vision of a society for its young. Now, when we talk of capabilities, we are talking of capabilities in terms of, probably to illustrate some examples of capabilities, would be capabilities with regard to thinking rationally. How do we value work? How can we contribute in terms of being a part of the workforce of society? What values with regard to that we hold with regard to working together with others? How do we appreciate one another in society? And these are all accomplished to the blocks of what we would term as the disciplines of studies that we would look at, okay, or the curriculum would look at. So in a way, we see that curriculum, broadly defined, is the vision for society. This vision is the socio-political and cultural vision that we have. And look at some definitions of curriculum. We will see curriculum relates itself to knowledge, understanding, and skills that fulfills the aims of education. Okay? To stretch it a little more or further that definition, we would see it also involves the criteria for selection of content, choices in methods, material, and evaluation. Now, these are all that relate to what then comes under this whole concept of curriculum. Now, when we look at this whole concept being so broad, we will see that there are many, many factors that interplay in order to see that this kind of knowledge, understanding, skills ultimately makes its way into the curriculum. And according to Winch 1996, we see that some of the trends that in curriculum design that we find, which influence curriculum design, are deep-rooted cultural attitudes, perceived importance of transferability, economic growth and welfare factors, changing demands of those who wish to be educated, along with those who educate. Okay, as teachers, what would we want to teach? As students, what we would want to learn? These are also factors that interplay in the whole curriculum design process. Economic factors, of course. Then what do we consider to be important? And these deep-rooted cultural attitudes. Now, when you look at all these multiple factors that is put before you, and of course, this list can go on, different ways in which we can classify this, we also see that curriculum has a political dimension. Now, when I say a political dimension at this point of time in the presentation, I would refer to it is a series of negotiations that we have in order to, for a certain content to reach the curriculum. Now, even though there may be agreed upon aims of education, we will see that these aims of education have different and multiple ways of being achieved. And therefore, how to be achieved will also be a contestable area. And there will be a lot of negotiations that happen along these lines. Okay, so when we say that this is because of constant negotiations, we say it has a political dimension. And most often that we would see that it is a particular class in society, usually the dominant class, that would make their views reach the space of the ultimate curriculum that is being framed or formulated. So with this brief idea of what then curriculum is, we would move next, right? We would move next to quickly go through the next couple of minutes only to understand this historical evolution, which is necessary for us to understand the analysis of curriculum. Now, in the 1920s, William Pinard tells us that curriculum studies began as a subfield of educational administration. Now, I want you to take note of the year 1920s. It was at this point of time in the history of the world that education now needed, formal education needed to be reached through the masses. It was that time of education in history where we would see that the factory model of education had begun to take its appearance in the scene of curriculum studies. And therefore, at that point of time, the function of this emerging that I have put into quote was the development of the curriculum and management of the curriculum. Now, these were primarily the two functions or the two aspects of a curriculum and what it should reach or what would the function of the curriculum reach, achieve. Then later on, as we moved on in history, as education kept evolving, as our understandings in the area of teaching, learning, knowledge, etc. kept evolving, you see a new word in the discourse of curriculum studies appear. The next slide, the word appears is reconceptualist. Now, these reconceptualists are people or individuals who challenge the tradition suggested in the function of curriculum being limited to the development of curriculum and management of curriculum. Now, as I said, as we evolved in history, as various social and political, economic forces interacted with the discipline of education, we see curriculum studies also evolved into a scholarly, a disciplined understanding of educational experience. And to understand this educational experience, it was understood from the perspectives of political, cultural, gender, historical frameworks, etc. So it evolved from development to a scholarly, and it is still evolving in terms of its concept and what should curriculum studies really encompass. And today we will look at how then we inquire into curriculum studies, for which we would look at the reading, or we have been provided with the reading according to McCormick and Murphy. He gives us one way of analyzing the curriculum. Now, according to McCormick and Murphy, he says, in the analysis of a curriculum, curriculum can be analyzed into the specified, the enacted, and the experienced curricula. These are three levels of analysis. Now, these levels of analysis have also gone through an evolution process. Now, when we see this, when we talk about specified curriculum, when we are talking about what is the aims of education, what should be included into this process of the curriculum or into the particular program for which the curriculum is being constructed? What is the methodologies that we are going to be using or is most appropriate or recommended, etc.? What is the vision that we have for the education through this particular program? We are looking at operating at the level of specified curriculum. So specified curriculum is nothing but what we would specify in terms of the content knowledge, in terms of the kind of pedagogies, in terms of what should be taught and how should be taught would be specified curriculum. Then we come to the next level of curriculum. The next level of curriculum is the enacted curriculum. Okay, the enacted, now as our understanding grew, as we made movements in our understanding of curriculum, teaching, learning, we saw that the specified curriculum is not all that gets really translated into the classroom. And therefore, curricularists became interested into how knowledge is selected, organized, transmitted, and evaluated. Now, therefore, the arena which would throw some light into how knowledge is selected, organized, transmitted, and evaluated is the arena of the classrooms. And that is nothing but enacted curriculum. Now, at this level, there are many mediating variables that operate that we need to understand. After the specified curricula is being in place or the vision has been conceptualized, but ultimately what happens would depend upon the enacted curriculum. And how really do teachers coming from different social spaces, cultural understanding, political leanings, how do they really enact, select, organize, transmit knowledge? Now, in the understanding as now, this came to be an understanding that it is specified curriculum and needs to also, we need to move further to include the classroom. We also then realize, related to this perspective, it is that when the curriculum is enacted, the students are not necessarily passive recipients of that, of the curriculum. There is a constant interaction, human interaction, that takes place between the teachers and the students. This interaction that takes place between the students and the teachers will now make a difference in the experienced curriculum. And therefore, related to the enacted curriculum was this whole next movement of understanding or broadening the understanding of the concept of curriculum to the experienced curriculum. Now, I would draw your attention to this box on the screen which says Godson's concept of curriculum. He said, curriculum he envisaged as a constructed, negotiated, renegotiated at number of levels and in a number of places. I have also mentioned this before, number of levels and places is how it becomes enacted, the mediating variables, what ultimately happens into the classroom, and what happens into the classroom when human beings interact with one another. We will see that again makes a change, because in the interaction, the kind of participation will determine the kind of knowledge that gets generated. The kind of knowledge then generated would then affect the various other levels of curriculum, and therefore there is a relationship that we need to take into account of human action, human learning, how learning takes place, how pedagogy really is translated into the classroom, and therefore we widen the scope of curriculum to an experienced curriculum as well. At all levels there are negotiations, renegotiations that take place. So we have these three levels of analysis, to repeat: the specified, enacted, and the experienced curriculum. Therefore, you see that curriculum studies included the ANINA, a repetition of what I said. And what then distinguishes these levels will be the abilities of the learners to learn or to receive. Now, here I would like to make a point that if learners are just passive recipients of information that is being provided, then the chances of the enacted curriculum and the experienced curriculum to be somewhat similar would be higher. But when learners are no longer passive recipients, we would see that the chances of enacted curriculum and experienced curriculum would be the difference in the two would be more probable. Okay, and therefore it was believed that learning is a social process. Learners' agency, teachers' agencies, etc., are recognized. And remember the first slide where we saw that in the factors that influence curriculum, it was also what students would want to learn and how they learn, and even what teachers would want to teach also being a factor. And this is how we'll see that in this nature of participation in the arena of the classroom, that curricula is enacted and experienced. And that also became the concern of curriculum studies and curriculists who are interested in the in what is curriculum. Okay, at this point of time, we'll take another poll. Okay, which of the following factors do you perceive as most important to understand curriculum construction? Society, culture, knowledge, learning. Okay, great. I think the results are in front of us and all of you can see it. It is society that 43% have put their responses for society, 14 for culture, knowledge, and 25 for learning. Great. This is a great indicator of what we think and what we believe in. Okay. So we'll see that in this whole understanding of the various factors that influence learning or contribute to, sorry, not influence learning, that contribute to curriculum construction, we had Murphy in 1990 who argued about how theories of learning would relate to these different levels or analysis of curriculum. Okay, so he looked at the relationship of learning theories and the levels of understanding. And so he argued that if we look at curriculum from the lens of learning theories, it would be able to relate to these different aspects of the analysis of curriculum. Why? It's on the screen for you. Okay? Because learning theories will inform us as to what is selected for inclusion into a curriculum. It will show light to us on what is to be selected while inclusion into a curriculum. It is through an understanding of how learning takes place, we would also know how, or the understanding and belief of how learnings take place would also give us how an understanding into how it is taught, the pedagogical strategies that are used in order to make sure that learning takes place. And it would also show us about the nature of the teacher's role in relationship to learners. And I'm sure this is familiar to all of us who have been exposed to some readings in curriculum. Okay, Hilda Tabar's Four Sources of Curriculum Construction. Again, take note of the year, 1962. Hilda Tabar said that there are four sources of curriculum considerations: sociological analysis, that is society, culture, when we understand culture and do anthropological analysis, when we consider knowledge, and that is a philosophical analysis, when we consider learning and do a psychological analysis. Okay, so this is what, how we are able to probably understand these four sources of curriculum consideration. And I think that's what we have been believing in ever since that time, since this great piece of work has been in the discourse of curriculum studies. So what has changed? Why do we look at it today in probably 2020? Okay, we look at it in 2020 because of our understandings of learning, which have evolved since then. We have made movements in understanding how learning takes place. In order to facilitate learning to take place, what should be done? What is the role of the learner and the teacher in the learning process? And what would we ultimately consider as learning has also changed. Now, any culture would tell us as to what would they want as the vision of their, for their young, as we saw before. What kind of knowledge should it incorporate? But a learning theory would link again over here, is based on how learning takes place, the definition of knowledge also keeps changing. Now, if you have gone through the NCF and the NCFTE, we would see that it all began with the vision of learning that is given. Okay, what is their vision for learning and a definition of what learning is, a conceptualization of what learning is. And therefore, from there, they evolved into a discussion on what is knowledge. And knowledge definitions also have gone through a change. So when learning definition changes, knowledge definition changes. When knowledge definition changes, we see that what then the vision for kind of knowledge to be provided to young also changes. And therefore, the processes that they envisage, any curriculum envisage for learning to happen also goes through a change. So learning, in a way, informs the other curriculum considerations or other sources get also informed by understandings of what learning is. So when we make movements in understanding of learning, we have also made changes in the spheres and in the domains of our psychological, our sociological analysis, psychological analysis, philosophical analysis, and anthropological analysis. And today, we will look at or an approach to look at curriculum analysis with a focus on learning theory. And we will first look at some contemporary views on learning and its bearing on curriculum analysis. For looking at the contemporary views of what learning is and its bearing on curriculum analysis, we will use the classification as given in the article provided to you by Bredow 1994, where there are different ways in which one can classify learning, but he uses this approach, these two classifications, and that is symbol processing view of the mind and situated view of the mind. So he broadly understand views, we will broadly understand views of learning from symbol processing views and situated views of the mind. Symbol processing views, it is this view that probably most of us have been brought up, educated into, and therefore most familiar to all of us in the field of education. Especially for teacher educators, we will all remember vividly how we have had to probably change from this view or consider different other views because this was so deeply entrenched in our thinking. And according to this view of learning, mind acts as a manipulator of symbols. Symbols are learned, they are stored in our memory. Then we search the memory for symbols when we require. We are confront those required symbols from our memory. We manipulate them from memory and we use them in order to resolve our problems. Okay, so learning broadly takes place like this. We acquire symbols, we learn through symbols, these we store in our mind. When required, we retrieve them from our mind and then use them by manipulating them to new situations and resolve our problems or make sense of our world or make sense of new situations based on the manipulation of symbols that exist already in our mind. Information processing theory is at one a part of the continuum of this thought, okay? Where learners are a passive processor of information. So when we process whatever information we get, how do we then process it into the mind through information processing theory is something that we are familiar with. We have the situated cognitive view of learning, okay, or situated view of learning. Now, this view of learning has been a view that is, most of us have considered in the recent past. This view includes all social constructivist view of learning. Okay, it stresses again on the role of others in creating and sharing meaning. We also see that there is a role of peer interaction to produce a cognitive conflict. So when we work with one another, when we interact with one another, we are confronted with a cognitive conflict. And when we are confronted with this cognitive conflict, we are then forced to change our thinking process. And therefore, this results in a change of thinking. And this change of thinking then it leads to the internalization of a concept of idea. And this all happens when we engage in culturally authentic activities. Okay, so when we talk of culturally authentic activities, we are talking of those kind of activities where we are close to reality, where it is a social milieu with which we are interacting and involving, and that is society itself. And it is through those interactions and participations in society that we are able to change, to internalize concepts, to make movements in understanding, and to play our role of meaning making in places where we are situated. And therefore, what helps in all this is community of practice. This community of practice comes from this situated view of learning, that we learn from one another. We learn when cognitive conflicts we confront. Okay, we encourage and one another, spur one another, help in one another's changing of concepts and our own. And what then is, therefore, when we see Wengner, he was one of the common proponents of the situated cognitive view of learning. He says communities of practice are groups of people who show a concern or a passion for something they do and learn, and how to do it better as they interact regularly. So learning happens then. Now learning, whether it's related to learning with regard to skills, learning with regard to content, learning with regard to hardcore disciplines such as mathematics, science, humanities, all these kinds of learnings through these disciplines, as well as learning to deal with one another, learning to cope and make sense of life and one another, all happens in communities of practice, okay, with interactions. So it is knowledge sharing, but when we have to share this kind of knowledge, it is equals to, as I put, extensive time and continuous interaction. So it is interaction over a period of time, not necessarily with the same group, but constant interaction as a feature, investment of time, sharing of knowledge, being with one another is what community of practice is all about. Now, let us look at, if we were looking at communities of practice, I would want to now quickly take maybe a minute or so in each one of you quickly reflecting back on our journeys as student teachers or teacher educators. Okay? When we began to engage in the discipline of education. And as I recollect my time, as I began from a student of entering into the discipline of education to engage with what education really is, then moved on to teaching. My journey as a teacher educator, and I spent 10 years at Somaya College of Education and then moved on to the university. At every point, I would remember that to be a teacher educator, it was not only the content of the definitions of what is education, what is the what is psychology of the learner, psychology of of the methods and educational technology subjects, etc., that contributed to who I am. But it was constantly interacting, looking at people who for me were significant, observing, learning from them, imbibing concepts, changing conceptual ideas that I had in my mind, and therefore moving from a peripheral participation to central participation. I'm using big words, but it's simply moving from the peripheries of involvement into concepts and the discipline to central positions in central participation in what really education, teacher education should be like. At the university, it is probably interacting with colleagues, learning from them, hearing from them, attending to different seminars, readings, their readings, research articles, new kind of knowledge and discussion that helped me move. And that's what he says. So when we look at learning from situated cognition point of view, we make movements from legitimate peripheral participation to central participation. This happens due to mutual understanding arising out of interaction and participation. So, with this interaction of the significant others, it helps in also transformation of identity, of who we really are. Who, when we learn these kind of content, is also another aspect of situated cognitive point of cognition point of view. Now, if we believe or lean on to the situated learning approach to learning, let us see how then this will link to the three levels of analysis, that is specified curriculum, experienced curriculum, and enacted curriculum. So how will they relate to one another? Okay, so if we believe in the situated cognitive point of view, we will see that we will, in the specified curriculum, we would include that kind of knowledge and practical activities, the knowledge which is knowledge that is evolved through practical activities, through activity-based learning, and therefore knowledge and practical activity would be inseparable in our understanding of knowledge. We would include concepts that are related to students' context. So we will contextualize the kind of context concepts that we are introducing. We will move from what students are familiar with, and we will try and see that learning revolves around their social context. We will make sure that learning involves community, and we would look how community and interactions would be used in our definitions of learning. So that is the specified curriculum that would take its change. Okay, or we would include these aspects in our specified curriculum. In our enacted curriculum, we will make sure that in the enacted curriculum, we would look into how then would this evolving knowledge or knowledge that is created through interaction make its way into the curriculum, into our interactions. So we will see that how we would use the resources, or how would we organize, select content, what kind of pedagogy strategies that we would use in order to make sure that these principles of situated learning approach are upheld, or it happens through the situation learning approach. And at the experienced level, experienced curriculum level, we will look at the nature of the teacher's role and relationship with the learners. So how would this relationship happen? How would learners interact with one another? How would they interact with the teacher? And therefore we see, friends, that if participation is so key to this whole thing, we will look at Rogoff's 1995. He identified the three interrelated perspectives of learning, okay? And he said that these interrelated perspectives of learning have three planes of analysis. Now let's look at planes of analysis later. First, he said that learning happens through apprenticeship, through guided participation, and through participatory appropriation. Now let's quickly look into what this means. Now when we are saying that learning happens through participation or through apprenticeship, it is nothing but learning the trade, learning the skills of the content, learning the skills of what we are interacting with by participating in different culturally established activities and organized practices. Okay? Secondly, we would look at learning happening through guided participation. Guided participation involves through observation as well as through hands-on experience. Thirdly, we would be concerned with, or we would look into, participatory appropriation is nothing but how individuals change through the process of learning. How individuals change through the process of learning. And I would want to make a statement here, and I want you to take keen note of what I am saying. It is all about, when we talk of participatory appropriation, it is all about the process of becoming rather than the process of acquiring knowledge. So, according to the situated cognitive view, Rogoff says, through these interrelated activities of apprenticeship, guided participation, and participatory appropriation, it is the process of becoming rather than the process of knowledge acquisition. Now, how does this happen? What are these three planes of at which they relate to? The three planes at which they relate to is the community, interpersonal relationships, and personal. Okay, these are the three planes at which apprenticeship, guided participation, participatory appropriation interacts with, intersects with community, interpersonal, and personal planes of analysis in participation. Quickly, in another 2 minutes, want you to reflect how the new BEd curricula makes provision for this kind of participation, or what aspects in the curricula do you see which have been introduced makes possibilities open for learning through participation. And in the chat, how, which are the some activities do you think in the BEd and MEd curricula that gives you opportunities for this kind of participation to happen? Great. I think this was wonderful and really fast to be able to see right from how you have seen methods of teaching and learning through internships, through your community engagement practices, through your EPC courses, professional development, as well as I was happy to see dissertations, collaborative activities, etc., making its appearance, these words in these ability courses, etc., making its way on this chat, okay? Through tours, yes. Okay, so that's excellent to see how we are able to see, because of the shift in curriculum, how. And friends, I want to draw your attention to this whole concept of internship. And many a times the criticism that we see, and we often, or not even criticism, we often look in wonder as to why is it that, you know, the NCTE recommends to us that the first few weeks of internship, we have to just be there and engage and watch and be part of the life of the schools in internship without doing much, doing into quotes I'm using. Okay, now this is nothing but this whole concept of being a part or participating in activities with others in cultural organizations such as the school. It is just being part of it that we learn the tricks, we learn the skills, and therefore we see apprenticeship over there. In the next, so that we say it's such, probably we all look at it as a waste of time. Let's go on, let's begin lessons. But it has a purpose there. And it is once that we probably get acquainted with the school, its happenings, we are able to adjust with the ethos, we move to guided participation, where we recommend that it is not observation of lessons, as well as we are seeing that you get opportunities to teach. Remember co-teaching with the teachers of the school, co-peer co-teaching, all these actually are not words, but these are in accordance to this whole idea of participation. And it is through this apprenticeship, guided participation, etc., that we then move on to see how we make changes in our own conceptual understandings, and we grow to be a person, and then learning per se for becoming a teacher is more about becoming rather than acquiring skills through probably micro teaching skills, through this kind of skills. So learning is no longer, or teaching or becoming a teacher is no longer restricted to mastery of skills alone, but through how you become and how you shape yourself, your identity as teachers in the space of community, interpersonal and personal planes. Therefore, in this view of learning, another word that we need to take home today with us is we need to see that collaboration, problem solving, ideas of dilemma are incorporated in the whole aspect of teaching and learning. Okay, so what is this collaboration, problem solving, ideas of dilemma going to help? It is going to help in arriving and reaching at shared understandings. Shared understandings where we are able in a community to be able to have a common understanding of what a particular concept, what a particular learning is all about, etc. And this happens just through these activities, not just through, it happens through the activities of collaboration, problem solving, and the ideas of dilemma. Thus, when we are part of communities of practice, according to Wenger and according to situated cognitive view of learning, that learning really takes place. Okay, so let's go in for another poll before we proceed. Okay, great. We've seen that most of us, or a majority of us, say that we will be willing to be a part of this community of practice. And we also appreciate those who are still not sure of being a part of this community of practice. And so with this idea in mind, we would mention, and friends, that's why we have this whole teaching and learning consortium, that is TALC, that we have created. Okay. Now, this group that we have created, through the group that you are, and each one of you that being part of these sessions are a part of TALC. And it is hoped, and it is our hope, it is our desire that it is through this group that we would talk to one another, we would place difficult situations to one another, before one another, to understand how each one of us have dealt with them in the past, are dealing with them in the present, and how we can encourage and spur one another to grow in our understandings of teaching and learning. And we negotiate, of course, it would not be only a, you know, time of encouragement alone, but it is through the process of negotiation that we are able to dialogue with one another and become a part of this. So being a part of this group, interacting on this platform that is TALC, that is provided to you, is an attempt on our part to create a community of practice for negotiation and dialogue. And remember, friends, that it is there in this, according to this view or any view of learning, okay, and also great philosophers have also opined this fact that the last slide, the important canon that we need to believe in, the knowing is in doing the knowing. Okay, so if we know what should curriculum be like, how should curriculum be, what should teaching and learning really be like, and how would we want it to be like? Okay, it is the beginning of it all would be in knowing, in doing what we know. And in the know, so therefore, I thought I would end by believing in the canon that the knowing is in doing the knowing. Okay, with this, I think any questions? Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. This presentation was really stimulating. So we do have some questions.
Wonderful presentation, Sybil ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, I would like to ask, in the whole scene of the curriculum, we have, as I know, the determinants of curriculum, the political, historical, and other things. Now, in the current situation, I am thought process is going on to technology. If you see, all the platforms currently are talking about technology. So where do you feel that technology would be a part of the curriculum in the coming years? How will the curriculum take a reformation of the whole curriculum, keeping technology in mind, or it will be taken as a separate one?
Okay.
So there are two more questions. Do you want to take them together?
Yes, one is asking,
can you please talk about transformation and upgradation in curriculum? And the other question is, do we have a plan when students don't learn? So
Lubna, when you said about technology, true, it is now, and especially the days that we are in right now, it is, technology seems to be everything right now, correct? And education equated to technology kind of a situation. But I would say that technology, when it is looked from the narrow view of probably, the gadgets, etc., that are involved in the whole thing, or a electronic medium that is involved, would be a means to reaching out to educational objectives and methodologies that would remain the same. But only the medium would be, now we would have to look at the challenges that the medium would provide to us for reaching out or accomplishing what we want to accomplish or see that our vision is realized.
Ma'am, I agree. But now when we frame the curriculum, it is a long-term objective or long-term that we keep in mind. So now you see, we all are so zapped here, the situation that we all are wanting to now learn as how we can cater and what we can do.
Yeah.
So we all are on these platforms now because of this.
So
don't you feel that now the curriculum need to be transformed? And we need to add the element where there has to be learning, as we say, life skills. In life skills, I think technology would be another life skill that would be added.
Yeah, so it would provide the knowledge required for developing capabilities to use technology.
Okay. But the third pertinent question is, what do we do when a learner does not learn?
Okay, now my whole problem with this is, does not learn means does he really not learn what we want him to learn? Okay, because I would like to believe that everybody is learning, but maybe not reaching the what we want or showing the kind of learnings that we want them to learn. And I think that would be a different different field or a different kind of a discussion altogether as to how do we deal or get people to do what we want them to or conceptualize the way we want them to conceptualize things. For the first task, I thought I've given you a variety of ones. Share some practices on this talk of building community of practices for student teachers and teachers and strengthen learning through COPs in these days of lockdown. So how can you suggest or what you are doing, some practices, put it onto TAL for strengthening COPs among student teachers. Two, what are some activities of participation that we can plan for ourselves to facilitate learning in the planes of community, interpersonal, personal domains? Okay, whether teacher, educators or students, how do we make deliberate plans to facilitate learnings at these different planes? Three, in the course of paper that you are studying or teaching, based on learning theories you subscribe to, we are not saying that you all have to write it based on situated cognition view to learning. You may even prescribe or a combination of both, whatever. You analyze how learning theory is reflected in the specified, enacted, and experienced curriculum. Second, reflect on how this learning theory can be related to specified, enacted, and experienced curriculum. Okay, so either way, levels of curriculum, if you could engage in one of these tasks or two of these tasks on the TAL group, we would be happy and much appreciate. Thank you.